In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Dear friends, invite you to the meditation on the second Sunday after Easter on a very interesting and a deeply spiritual experience that is found on the 21st chapter of St. John's Gospel. This is about the hospitality of the resurrected Lord. I would say it's a kind of series, at least the coming two messages, the hospitality on the seashore of Galilee. The following one would be hospitality, at a far off village in the desert. But today I would like to read a small portion from the 21st chapter of St. John's Gospel, a few verses for you. Appearance on the shore of Tiberias. Later on, our Lord Jesus showed himself again to the disciples. It was by Sea of Tiberias, and it happened like this. Simon Peter, Thomas called the twin, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two more of his disciples were together. Simon Peter said, "I am going fishing." They replied, "We will come with you." They went out and got into the boat, but caught nothing that night. It was light by now, and others stood Jesus on the shore, though the disciple did not realize that it was Jesus. Jesus called out, "Have you caught anything, friends?" And when they answered, "No," he said, "Throw the net out to the starboard and you will find something." So they dropped the net, and there were so many fish that they could not haul it in. The disciple Jesus loud said, "Peter, it is the Lord." All these words, "it is the Lord," Simon Peter, who had practically nothing on, wrapped his cloak around him and jumped into the water. The other disciples came on in the boat, towing the net and the fish. They were only about 100 yards from the Lord. Friends, greetings to you all in the most precious name of our common Lord, who is resurrected one. And today it is discovering or identifying the resurrected Lord in our workplace. And each one, we are engaged in one or the other work in this earthly abode. We have our own vocations, our own jobs, employment. And at every part of our job, it's very interesting to note that our resurrected Lord is always with us, those who believe in him. It is in that context we go through this particular section of St. John's Gospel for our meditation. In fact, it is a perfect conclusion for St. John's Gospel at 20th chapter. And after 20 chapters of the description about the personhood of Jesus, and then suddenly it appears at the end, the appendix on the title of 21st chapter, which is almost an epilogue, like, first chapter of St. John's Gospel, 14 verses were called as prologue, and this is epilogue. In fact, chapter 21 very well fits into the ecclesiological, that means the nature of the church. Then Christological, that means the personhood and function of Jesus. The third one is missiological, that means how Jesus gave commission for the disciples to become apostles. Ecclesiological, Christological, and missiological aspects can be seen in this chapter. The venue is very interesting. This place, called Tabgha. తప్పగా ఐ విల్ ఎక్స్ప్లెయిన్ టు యూ ఇన్ ఎ లిటిల్ వైల్. ఇట్ ఈస్ ఎగ్జాక్ట్లీ పర్హాప్స్ ద సేమ్ ప్లేస్ వేర్ జీసస్, యు నో, హీ చోజ్ హిస్ డిసైపుల్స్, అట్లీస్ట్ 7 ఆఫ్ ది డిసైపుల్స్, దోస్ హు బిలాంగ్ టు ది రీజియన్ ఆఫ్ గ్యాలిలీ. అండ్ ఇట్ ఈస్ ఇన్ ద సేమ్ ప్లేస్, పర్ఫెక్ట్ కంక్లూషన్, దే ఆర్ మీటింగ్ అగైన్. ఇట్ ఈస్ దో ఇట్ ఈస్ నాట్ కోయిన్సిడెన్స్, దెర్ వాజ్ అ పర్పస్ ఇన్ మైండ్ ఆఫ్ అవర్ లార్డ్ జీసస్ క్రైస్ట్. దిస్ ప్లేస్ ఈస్ కాల్డ్ తబ్గా, విచ్ ఈస్ ఆల్సో కాల్డ్ హెప్టాపెగోన్ ఇన్ గ్రీక్. వీ షుడ్ రియలైజ్ దట్ దిస్ ల్యాండ్ వాజ్ రూల్డ్ బిఫోర్ ద రోమన్స్ కేమ్. దే వర్ రూల్డ్ బై గ్రీక్, యూనో, లైక్ ఆఫ్టర్ అలెగ్జాండర్ లెఫ్ట్ హీస్ వైసగరెంట్స్ అండ్ ఫర్ కమింగ్ 200-300 ఇయర్స్ the Greeks ruled and followed by the Romans. So they changed the places, you know, which is common. Every government that comes in afresh, even in India, we have a lot of changes on the names of towns and cities sometimes. So Heptapegon is, actually it is the seven angled table, Heptapegon. But in this context here is about seven springs, which is called the village of Heptapegon, or the village of Thabga is also an Arabic expression, which means simply seven, springs. And it is exactly seven disciples who are also called in this place. Ultimately, wherein there is a small chapel called St. Peter's Primacy, that means where Peter came back again to the feet of our Lord Jesus, where he was forgiven and he was kind of restored back to the apostleship. It is on the northwestern shore of Sea of Galilee, and it is also a place where the first miracle took place, you know, feeding of 5,000, the bread and fish were given. This is the fourth resurrection experience. Friends, it is here the mission of Christ would be evidently seen. In fact, the original name of the Jewish community called it as, Ein Sheva. Again, the same name, seven springs, Ein Sheva. And now when you come, I will explain to you a few more interesting things later on this place. We should know that, the witness of the resurrected Lord begins from the fact of empty tomb. Witnessing the empty tomb, people, at least the women have gone and they came back, reported this matter to the disciples. Disciples ran there, John ran first, but gave importance and primacy to Peter to go into the tomb. However, they witnessed. And secondly, the resurrected Lord appeared in the midst of the disciples at the upper room, wherein he brought the celestial peace, the shalom, to them. In spite of this, the disciples were somehow adamant to either believe it or not able to digest this, fact of his resurrection. It is surprising, it is mystery to them. However, the disciples returned back. At least those who came from Sea of Galilee, the seven disciples came from that region and they returned back. It is also a possibility the angel at the empty tomb advised them to go to Galilee. It is there the resurrected Lord encounters you. Quite possibly they would have come back listening to that commission. Because why, search the living among the dead? He is risen, he is no more here. He has gone to Galilee, he will meet you there. So it was very clear. Galilee is the place which has given the majority of the disciples. And the disciples returned back. Peter said, we will go back for fishing. I am going at least. And the remaining disciples said, okay, we will also come with you. Because the disciples were tired, frustrated, they were touchy, baffled. hungry and they didn't know what to do because for the last 3.5 years their daily routine work was simply to follow Jesus and there was nothing you know for their personal life to decide upon their own goals and night was a good time for fishing of course the experts of fishing Peter was there and they went into the sea that night time is the more productive time for the fish catch of the fish and it is there I think they went in but then we are surprised to see that the whole night they spent in the sea in spite of the fact the whole night they spent they didn't catch a single fish that's because not that they are failure at their work they are very expert senior persons in that profession like Peter and others Andrew the reason that they could not catch was they did not make any effort to my knowledge their minds were totally you know with vacuum they are blank suddenly after 3.5 years returning back to area of Galilee and not knowing what to do and without the accompaniment and fellowship of our Lord Master Jesus Christ and they were blank shall we call it as a spiritual vacuum in their life definitely a vacuum and Peter when he went out to catch the fish they did not find and in the absence of Jesus and it is exactly there you know Peter was shown by John that master was standing there because our Lord asked them did you catch any fish they said no thinking that he was a stranger who was asking but then at the direction of our Lord to try on the starboard side that means the right side of the boat and when they tried it they had a very big catch of the fish and it is at that point John probably he did a gesture like this and told our Lord it is our Lord oh that was a fantastic expression by the youngest disciple who was beloved of the Lord and Peter suddenly wrapped his cloth around his waist and jumped into the water either didn't know what to do or he wanted to go first to meet the Lord whichever way it is interesting to note that Peter and John paired in several other occasions like this despite their age gap the senior most disciple and the junior most perhaps the oldest and youngest they are paired in the latter part of the gospel also not only here when you compare it to chapter 19 verse 35 it was the John's witness what they call trustworthy witness again it is mentioned on chapter 20 verse 8 that means John and Peter were together at the seeking the Lord in the tomb John though as young man reached first but he gave place to Peter the affirmation of reliable authorship authenticity was given to John's witness Simon Peter now dragged the big net to the shore with its abundance of fish and they caught 153 big fish they say the numbers are funny you know in Israel also it's like in India we run to buy you know the numbers to get to number 9 probably that is the that's the maximum of the single digit number a lot of people try to get that you know in fact 1 plus 5 plus 3 is also 9 we don't know what is inherent in it but definitely today's world it symbolizes 153 big historic churches existing in the world today well, let us not take it in that manner, because church is growing. But the big fish, the intention was fish for people, not for themselves. Lord Jesus said, I will make you fishers of men, at the beginning when he called Peter. And now perhaps it was reminding of Peter by giving him a chance of witnessing 153 big fish. It's an opportunity for realignment of relationship, restoration of relationship with the Lord. The fallenness of Peter was given an opportunity to stand and to reach out the resurrected Lord. Could this be a spiritual impact in the mind of Peter? Peter, you know, and John reflect very much more towards forming a community of resurrected Lord. And where Jesus as resurrected Lord becomes the center, to form a Christocentric community in the world for next generation. Friends, in the light of this, can we see the spiritual implications? To me, it appears that catching the, you know, abundant fish in the midst of the vacuum where their master was not with them, and Peter decided to go for fishing. The abundant catch of fish is symbol of church's, you know, expansion in the world. Fish is symbolically in the first two centuries, when they were hiding and proclaiming the gospel and witnessing, worshipping, fish was the first symbol for Christians to know each other. You know, in Greek, ichthus means fish. When you write Greek letters, I, you know, if you can also read Isus, you know, he in Greek letter like X, Christos, Theos, Huios, and Soter. That means Isus, Christos, Theos, Huios, Soter. Means Jesus Christ, Son of God, the Savior. These are the letters come from ichthus. Otherwise, ichthus means the fish. It's very important to know this symbolism. They were called to catch the fish as the fisher folk community, as the big fishermen led by Peter. They were reminded of going to fish the people for church, for Christ. The second one is, to me, rehabilitation to Peter is calling back the disciples in general, but in particular to Peter, to remind his commitment and his vocation. You know that he was three times Peter was, you know, he denies. At the time of the charcoal, when they reached the shore, a charcoal was lit and master was waiting. He said, friends, bring some fish, we will, eat it here, cook it here and eat. At the time there was a charcoal, you know. The moment Peter saw the charcoal, means the small fiery place, he was reminded of the place where at Caiaphas' house, he denied three times his master. Now again charcoal. Now it is exactly where in the next part of the section, in the chapter, Jesus asks Peter three times, do you love me? Wherein he entrusts Peter to become his servant, pastor or the chief shepherd, to catch the fish, for people. It is in this context, a rehabilitation of Peter, restoration, and then he was given the importance, Peter's primacy. It is exactly, the chapel is named there. It's a Benedictine monastery. Peter's primacy, it is called Peter's primacy, and it is there exactly. He invites the disciples, come, he calls them children. Now, at one time he called, you know, disciples as friends when he was washing the feet of the... Now, he is calling them children because you should know by now is Jesus is ascended now in the sense transformed into the resurrected status of the Lord. You know, the supreme status of the Lord. He is again different from these humans now. The purpose after the purpose was over. So he calls them children, the believers. Come, you eat something. Inviting them signifies and symbolizes the sacramental significance, you know, at this point. The beginning of the Eucharistic practice in the life of the church, how it plays very important role in strengthening and deepening the spiritual experiences of the people of God. Breakfast was hosted by the resurrected Lord. You will find this is first time, but you will also find later on second time he hosts at some other place like Emmaus, the sacrament. That's why this place is called Mensa Christi, means the table of Christ. The undivided rock is there, a big rock. A part of the rock was taken into the small chapel, Peter's primacy, and that becomes the altar. And a part of rock is kept outside. It was so fascinating for us whenever I took pastors or bishops into that place, you know, to show. And that's exactly outside the rock we celebrated the Holy Communion several times. Very holy place, the table of the Lord, Mensa Christi. Friends, it is here he will call them for the vocation of mission. Witness of the, you know, authentic witness of the beloved disciple. It is from there the disciples are called now missionaries with a mission. At Matthew's 28th chapter verse 16 follow, more or less at the same place, go ye into the world to proclaim this gospel, you know, making disciples. Mission was entrusted. Friends, I am the bread of life is reminded here. In his one of the seven sayings of Jesus, as a resurrected Lord, he reiterates that saying, I am the bread of life. On the sixth chapter, when a small boy brought, you know, five small barley bread and two fish, he multiplied and gave to 5,000 people. It is the same place. I think it is the same place. When Lord turned the water into wine, you know, he revealed himself, he revealed his glory. And again, the same verse it says here, he revealed himself in this place at the charcoal, and he revealed as the resurrected Lord, entrusting them with the apostolic mission. I send you. He revealed himself as Lord of life. If you call that incarnation as Epiphany, and this is called the Ephanerosen. Ephanerosen is revealed himself as Lord of life, the resurrected one. Friends, it is the same place where the Byzantine church existed for 300 years and more, which starts from 312 AD to 636. You know, there with mosaic in that chapel on the ground. A mosaic is beautifully decorated with fish and the bread loaves. And on the wall, the decoration of peacock is there. And it's only to show the ancientness of the Byzantine church's witness in the Benedictine monastery. And now, when there is no Jesus, they were empty, and there was a kind of spiritual vacuum in their life. With Jesus, you know, they came back again to witness the glory of the resurrected Lord. Secondly, Jesus, a stranger, comes here. Remember, again, in the next message also, you will find Jesus, a stranger, walking with the disciples. Here, the stranger, the resurrected Lord, invites them, come, eat. He invites them, for a very specific purpose, the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, in our own workplace where we reinitiated. You know, Peter, unfortunately, he started again the fishing, but was reminded. Friends, the fourth resurrection experience, it is in the midst of the vacuum, spiritual vacuum, the Lord, resurrected Lord, fills their lives, renewing their lives, renewing the call as disciples, as apostles. And resurrected Lord transforms their lives to become the martyrs in the latter days who would establish the unshakable church on the Mensa Christi, the table of Christ, undivided, indivisible rock, the body of Jesus Christ. Friends, it's a tremendous experience of the resurrection. We need to experience this in our own personal lives, in our families, in our churches. When we don't invite Jesus, the resurrected Lord, into our houses, you have the shell of the house, but not the living Jesus, who would activate our lives as living witnesses. We need him in our lives as the center of our life and activity and witness. Only then you can testify the resurrected Lord, to show that our family and we as the resurrected people in our lives. Friends, shall we, in a moment of silence, invite our Lord into our families, into our midst, once again to renew our spiritual experiences. And may we depend on that body of our Lord, sharing his body and blood, and sharing the resurrected experience, that we show to the world that we all are alive in Jesus. Lord of life, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, amazing to look at the great, fabulous experience that you have bestowed to your disciples, Lord, in giving them the experience of plenty, abundance of catch of fish. You only told them that without me, you gain nothing. But with me, you are plenty in abundance. Lord, be with us, O Lord. Not for the worldly prosperity, but with full of spiritual experiences and gifts that you brought upon our lives. Lord, give us that experience of that living nature because of your resurrection. As you changed the disciples into apostles and missionaries, give us an opportunity, Lord, to proclaim this authentic gospel of resurrection of yours to our friends and neighbors, to tell that this church is alive, it is not dead. May we experience that resurrection of yours in our lives. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, love of God, and the continued fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us and abide with us always. Amen. Thank you.